Qualified for the round of eight. Now, for those of you unfamiliar with the tournament format, we have four teams who have qualified from the offline qualifier portion. The remaining eight teams in the round of 12 are going to be the 3rd through 10th place LCK teams. Now, these guys will play single best of one eliminations, as we've seen already, to decide who will advance to the round of eight alongside SK Telecom, KT Bolster, and now Anarchy. From there, they'll move on to the round of four on the shores of Busan before moving on to the finals. And the winner of the entire tournament will not only receive a large prize pool, as I stumble over my words, but also qualify for IEM Cologne.
Doing okay there, buddy?
It's going to be a long day.
It was an explosive first series. Obviously, congratulations to Rebels Anarchy beating Najin out. But this time around, we have Young Boss versus CTU Pathos.
Of course, two teams that we don't know a whole ton about. Now, luckily for me, as a former LMS caster, I have a little bit of an advantage in this series because Kramer, the current ADC for Young Boss, is the substitute AD carry for the Flash Wolves. Now, Kramer was originally picked up due to incredible mechanical skill, but never really had that same communication, same synergy with a mostly or predominantly Chinese team, or Chinese-speaking team, rather.
Now, naturally, there are a lot of question marks on kind of what kind of performance are going to come out of both of these teams, but I think it's interesting about the development of talent in Korea, the fact that we are seeing two kind of challenger-esque teams coming into such a high-profile event like the Tesco Cup, formerly of StarCraft, now moving over into League of Legends, and kind of see what kind of performance they put up, what kind of looks they give.
Now, I lost my train of thought because I'm pretty sure that the uniform, I don't know if it's his jacket or if they have uniforms, but it is two outlines of women sitting back to back, and if that is actually their uniform, I will be very surprised.
Their name is Young Boss.
Like two trucker mud flaps back to back on that guy's. Okay, side tangent, focusing back in on the games, the thing that I love about younger teams with newer, fresher faces and talent is that they have generally have a lot more aggressive mentalities. They're a lot more eager to have flashy plays, and as a result, the games are much more exciting.
I keep looking for mudflap ladies, and
you see it?
No, I don't.
I'll point at the monitor. Someone somewhere has seen it and agrees with me, or I'm crazy.
I think you're just crazy. Like, I know their name's Young Boss, and it's a okay. Speaking of jerseys, I totally. I think I almost wore that sweater out in the wardrobe, but they came in and they changed into their team jerseys, which happened to be that sweater. I think I watched that one.
Yeah, it was a little bit hectic there in the wardrobe. I almost took a Najin jersey, you know? It was.
We're sitting down there getting our makeup done, and okay, it is. It is the mud flap
with Pathos,
ladies.
Though. That's not Young Boss, that's Pathos. Oh, all right.
That is so
uniform.
Excellent.
Hysteria aside, that is a great uniform. That rivals early Koo Tigers, or rather, yes, when
the
they
Tigers.
Were the Koo Tigers, now known as the Tigers, rivals their early uniform sensibilities, of course. Gray sweaters, just as sensible, a little simpler, though, on the side of Young Boss. They don't need to show off.
They're the boss.
They're the Young Boss, yeah.
That was a bad joke.
That was so bad. So once again, so for this set, the thing that we have to preface everyone with is that these are young teams. They don't have a ton of screen time, not a whole lot of known names. One or two streamers, one or two high ELO players.
Mimic, I think, is the primary streamer.
But
they move.
It's going to be very interesting to see how they play as a team of five. You can see Kramer on your screen there. Taking a little bit of break time with the Flash Wolves. I believe it's been clarified that he is not off the Flash Wolves lineup, but that he has just been given the freedom to come and play in this tournament.
And a lot up for grabs. Again, 88,000 USD for the first place winner, punching your ticket to IEM Cologne to represent Korea. So this is technically a qualifier tournament. So, you know, little off season, little qualification run. Not bad for Kramer's resume there.
Definitely looking pretty solid alongside playing with the Flash Wolves. Now, I think this is a team looking pretty confident. Maybe Stone Face as they come into this game. No one looking too shaky, although a lot of smiles on the Young Boss lineup, looking pretty happy to be here in general. It's really going to be interesting to see stylistically what these two teams develop into over the course of this best of three, and additionally, what the priorities are going to be in pick and pin. These guys have a little bit more information about each other than we do about them up front, but there's still just not a ton of evidence either way. This is not a Najin, this is not an Anarchy, this is not a team that has played in a regular season as much, and as a result, there's just not the evidence to prep the same way that you could for a best of three against one of these LCK teams.
And they're not the only Korean challenger teams joining us in this tournament. We also have winners and ever down the line course ever, a bit more up and coming. They lost their spot in LCK to Spinu.
And to be fair, I think that was they did get a single win.
They got a single win because Spinu didn't ban Gangplank.
Gotta respect the Gangplank. So.
Watch that.
It's an interesting game, for sure. I'm really hoping this is the dream. Whenever we see teams like that, you can see our casting booth just hidden in the corner.
Yeah, we're actually that little bird cage up there.
Yeah, they put a screen in front of us so Frostburn wouldn't try to poach any of the players.
Which is why I'm so happy to be seeing up and coming Korean talent. Got to get my my reports in to LPL. It's looking bad, boys. We're not winning much.
I've lost it. Kramer, we're just waiting to get in picks and bans here. And, of course, we discussed tournament format. We discussed implications. And while there's a lot of flexibility for a lot of these established LCK teams, these guys who have qualified or just qualified into this round of 12 are going to have their very set, very established roster of five that they'll probably
Kramer
use
is playing
for all
jungle.
Their games.
It's nonstop in the top lane. Kramer in the jungle, 19 in mid.
I'm pretty sure that that's backwards, and it's Kramer ADC nonstop support.
Oh, man. I never
I know
to
you're
look at...
excited.
It's because I'm in the bird cage, and I got, like, the screen in front of me that I can't see the other side. But here we go, into draft phase. It's going to be Young Boss on the blue side, Pathos on the red side.
Bring it to you from the bird cage.
From the bird cage.
Instant TF ban being brought out here. We've seen exactly how effective the high mobility and the map pressure that TF can put out. Definitely an interesting ban to start off. Not sure if that's a target ban or just something generally powerful in the meta. Use both. Master Yi taken away. Now, I do know one of these players is actually known for his Master Yi mid.
I would hope so. You can always tell when we've entered kind of the chaos of up-and-coming talent when a Master Yi ban goes down. You know it's about to get real.
The question is, how deep do the champion pools go? Do we have these one-trick ponies? Lissandra coming out as well, so a lot of... I would say mid lane focus coming in from both teams because I do believe that is the mid lane Master Yi ban. And Lissandra, Twisted Fate, Ryze, Veigar, I believe all the mid laners you listed that we expected to see as popular. Lulu also being taken off the table.
Permaban all day.
Always going to be relevant. So much utility, so much early damage, a solid lane bully. And all the focus is on mid lane in this setting, or in this pick ban so far.
Yeah, I'm actually really surprised that we haven't seen Veigar come out quite yet. Again, it's pretty much been bouncing between Ryze, Lissandra, and Twisted Fate. Kindred now going to hit the bench. So I can confidently say that Anarchy getting their hands on Kindred was probably the one-off of the day.
I don't think we're going to see any other team. No team will have a good strategy to deal with it. You have displacements that can interrupt your ult, but when you're in a position where you have to ult people away from Lance Respite as a Gragas or as a Lee Sin, you're just already losing your team fight. Karth is also taken off the table. Welcome to the joys of Challenger teams, ladies and gentlemen. I remember the Karth is also being someone's pocket pick, so.
Again, I would hope so. Okay, so we've got a ton of mid lane bans. We'll see what's left. Ryze is still up and available. I predicted him to be the must pick or ban of the tournament. I think he's way too strong with everything he offers, but we'll see if Young Boss and Pathos agree with me as Young Boss taking their time with their priority pick. Other big picks left up is the Fiora. Any pick of the jungle.
Of course,
not. Kalista.
You're just going to list off the things that you want to see?
Tahm Kench.
I think Ryze...
Gangplank.
We forgot he was a champion. He's literally never been allowed through in eons. We just forgot he existed. Of course, Gangplank has received some nerfs on the current patch. His parlay no longer refunds mana on kill. So a little bit more mana hungry in the laning phase may affect his build path, may slow down that snowball, but still overall a powerhouse of a champion.
I don't think it's really going to affect his build path. He still has one of the most expensive build paths in the game. Trinity into double Infinity Edge, I think is what Soaz popularized. Pirate Pawn, also bringing that one out. Anytime I get the chance to say Pirate Pawn, I'm going to go for it. But we'll see if it's going to be a Gangplank in the top lane or in the mid. Pathos taking their time, but they will answer with Thresh Kalista. So looking for that objective control. Thresh Kalista obviously has a very high mechanical ceiling in how these champions interact in tandem with each other.
And once again, Thresh just always going to be a relevant champion in any meta. His kit offers so much utility, engage potential, and
vision.
I think every support main ever as far as I know, has played Thresh at some point in their life, and it just seems to be a staple in every professional player's champion pool. Kalista, additionally, absolutely a powerhouse when she can get ahead in the early game, and what character to help give her a better early lead.
See what the response is. Typically when a Kalista goes down, you're looking for Ashe, Tristana, Maokai. Obviously, Ashe able to kind of stick a little bit better to Kalista with the slow, has the hard CC on the arrow. Tristana can follow Kalista's martial poise with her satchel on the damage. And it's none of those. It's actually Varus, but that could be mid lane.
Or it could go to Kramer.
Yeah.
Now, Flash Wolves are known for having a pocket pick Varus and playing very, very well around it. I believe both Kramer and NL play this. This is, of course, a different lineup. It'll be interesting to see how they play, but we have an immense amount of poke building up in this team. Poke and pick potential. The Cocoon, the Gragas Barrels, the Varus' piercing arrows, but still not a whole lot given away, honestly. We have a Varus as a flex pick and a Gangplank as a flex pick on the side of Young Boss, but Olaf and Evelynn, the quick lock-ins here on the side of Pathos.
So they see a low mobility AD carry like Varus. Again, we'll see if that ends up in Kramer's hands or if it goes into the mid lane for some poke action. And they immediately grab Olaf, who just has so much kill pressure on the back lane with his ultimate.
And of course, a decent answer to Varus. He is going to have a reliable way to lock down the enemy team, or at least a single target, depending on how the grouping works up.
I think lock down. I think like run down, mow down, chase down.
Talking about Varus. Olaf, yes, is going to run down and chase down people, and there's nothing Varus can do to stop that. But without the corrupted arrow as a safety net, he may be very vulnerable. A highly immobile AD carry, really no kiting tools outside of the hail of arrows and his ultimate.
Look at that poke comp. Okay, so they pick up the Corki and the Alistar's last rotation on the side of Young Boss, so surely that will be the Varus mid lane. Now Varus is going to itemize very similar to Jace in terms of his power spike coming in the mid lane, and it's pretty much just about spamming that Q every 4 seconds. Now, they do also add an element of pick because they do have the Elise. Good follow-up CC and disengage from Alistar, but this is typically a relatively difficult composition to execute, and final pick is Vladimir.
Vladimir, a very interesting pickup in this exchange. Kalista, of course. Kalista and Thresh, really the only form of hard engage for this team as a whole, but an immense amount of rundown. It looks like a Vladimir mid lane, although I'm not entirely sure.
It makes sense to put Vlad into the mid lane. I mean, Olaf still will technically have kill pressure on Varus, so I'm not going to discount Olaf mid. Thanks, Faker. Vladimir into a poke comp, because as they try to whittle him, once he's post level 9 and he has 5 points into his Q, he's just able to lifesteal that, spell vamp, that backup, fairly effectively and quickly.
And of course, it'll be interesting to see. We haven't seen a Vladimir in a long time. It'll be interesting to see how the team plays around him. Of course, really needs to hit those multi-target Nemo plagues, but scales very comfortably into the late game. On the opposite side, we have kind of an insane mid game on this Pokemon. Varus, once he starts to stack that tier. Corki, once he gets that level 6. Overall, just a very strong composition in terms of poke, but very one-dimensional in what it wants to do.
Have the mid-game power. Now, it is really reliant for Eve and Vladimir to find the flanks, so we'll see if they can set up their posture and get the team fight.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are about to make our way into game one between Pathos and Young Boss. Don't go anywhere. And we're back in the first game of our second set of the day between Young Boss on the blue side and Pathos on the red. It's going to be an interesting set of matchups. It's purely poke against a very, I would say, interesting composition coming in here from Pathos. I'm not sure what to think of this one.
It's a teamfight composition. You have a lot of synergy between Evelynn and Vladimir if they're able to stack their AoE ultimates. I'm going to call it the Venn diagram of murder. But Vladimir and Evelynn are very reliant on flanking as opposed to what I like to call a front-to-back engagement or running across the scrimmage line of the enemy team.
It feels like this is the Venn diagram versus, like, the line graph. You got the arrows, you got the rockets. It's like, which one is really more effective for mapping your data.
No, that's a good way to put it.
You tried so hard not to leave me out to try, and I appreciate that. That was awful.
I had to come back and get you, but you left me out to dry on the almond.
It's true.
That's okay.
It was a nutty reference.
Standard 5 point coming out from both teams. It looks like we also will have a jungle start. Mimic, the streamer, going to go ahead and start on the wolf camp, while Hippo, I love their names, starting off with the leash gromp for Beggar.
19 looking to play pretty aggressive in this lane already. Kramer, pretty comfortable with this early Gromp start. He's been around, he's played with professional team, he's scrimmed with flash rules plenty. I don't expect him to look too uncomfortable. How he'll stack up against Gap and Mocha, though, will be very interesting as well. Mimic sporting the new Marauder Olaf skin. That's one of my personal favorite skin lines. Not very comedic, but I think it looks very good aesthetically.
Yeah, it's pretty. See where he's going to go from here. Makes the quick back and is going to go ahead and teleport. Will reach the lane first. Also has his level 2 available. Hippo will be shortly joining him.
Relatively calm here. Kramer and Nonstop should have a small EXP advantage.
And I want to quickly underline the differences between the itemization and the top laners, simply because they've had their first recall with teleport. You have Flask, Pink Ward, Mana Pod priority from Hippo. So looking to set down a lot of those barrels, take the lane phase very easy with poke damage, versus Mimic taking the nice hidden barrel in there in the brush. Taking the Doran's Blade and just really looking to brute force lifesteal the lane.
And when we think about popular streamers, when we think about solo queue all-stars, it's got to be all about aggressive early laning phases, and Mimic is obviously no stranger to that. We'll have to see if he can find any greater advantage. Currently happy with the CS lead he has, 13-6, although that may change as this wave crashes into the tower. We'll see how comfortable Hippo is farming under it and how aggressive Mimic wants to get, the barrel offering him a little bit of zone protection here.
Other itemizations of note is, of course, Vladimir taking the Boots Pots start, giving him a good head start on trying to dodge out the majority of Varus' damage with that Q poke. That said, low levels, Varus is mostly just going to look to auto-attack harass you now. Power of Varus mid lane is obviously once he gets more points in those Q and he lowers that cooldown, he can effectively clear the entire length of mid lane as well as poke you if he connects with a piercing arrow.
And additionally, the Blight stacks will do an effective job of punishing Vladimir for that scaling health, really not let Vladimir take full advantage of that passive, as it will just increase Varus's auto attack damage if he is able to proc it with an ability. So an interesting matchup for sure, and you gotta give a lot of credit to Mangchi. It's an interesting adaptation. I'm just not sure how it's going to work out for him.
This is actually really smart of Beggar as well. So obviously there's not an open gank on Mangchi here. That was a tough one. I had to really look at it. He's waiting for the counter gank from Doko, looking for the Evelynn to extend on the Varus that far forward in the lane. So good awareness and communication so far being demonstrated by young boss to have his jungle shadow underneath him.
And additionally, a pink ward placed in the rear top brush here for Hippo. Definitely does not want to get flanked. Knows that he's relatively safe with the oranges and the speed boost that he can get from those barrels, but just taking it the extra mile and just knowing that he wants to farm up, knowing that he wants to stay out of Evelynn's hair. Evelynn, though, may have a different plan for him. He has to be careful in this exchange. Starting to run away from Mimic. Could be in trouble here. Reckless Swing coming out. Doko going to be spotted, but the Pink Ward not going to help whatsoever. Far too aggressive, and First Blood going over to the Evelynn. Pathos making a strong remark.
And I understand your theory behind placing the Pink Ward in that first brush, because obviously you're hoping to freeze the wave in front of your tower or near your tower so that it will give you a lot of protection if Eve enters from the river. But he's just way too far forward. Wasn't able to push the wave, reset it correctly, and get it centered, and really pays the price there. Burns his flash and doesn't have his teleport available.
Definitely an unfortunate trade there. Olaf now up to 34 CS. In addition to that assist, comfortable picking up a Kindle Gem. And Olaf can be so oppressive when he gets ahead. The undertow, when he has full mana, just able to chase you down in lane gangplank, really, with no hard CC options. Not that they'd be too relevant, as Mimic does approach level 6 here. And overall, things seem to be going quite well for Pathos, farming themselves up to a pretty decent lead. 47-37 in the bot lane. Kramer is a player with a decent amount of professional experience, and he's falling very quickly behind Gap here.
Thresh versus Alistar. Again, the fact that you have the advantage of having a ranged support. Obviously, I can't comment too heavily on it just because we haven't had the bot lane. as it appears on our screen right in front of me, but just look at the zoning potential coming out of Gap and Mocha and their reach and threat, especially when there's no creep line in front of Nonstop and Kramer. The death sentence is just that deadly. So really just respecting the 2v2 mismatch.
Hippo.
And again, the pink ward.
Rinsing and repeating that strategy, hoping to get Beggar into the top lane safely, trying to get something back, help himself scale up. It looks like they're just going to try to push this lane up.
They're just trying to reset it, yeah, just because Mimic's done a great job trying to freeze it. That shouldn't amount to much.
Nonstop getting aggressed on here. Not too many spears inside of the Ren. Not going to dish out too much damage, but...
split their damage. The fact that Gap is attacking Kramer, meanwhile Mocha is locking up Nonstop.
But they still look really good with the synergy. Gotta give them a little bit of credit there.
It's all about that style.
I just appreciate the skin choices coming in here from Pathos.
Beggar needs to step forward and he needs to get some wards on Doko's camps, is what needs to happen. So obviously Evelynn will come out of stealth when she takes her camps, which means that if you ward the camps, you can figure out which side of the map she's on and play accordingly. It would definitely save Hippo a lot of gold from warding behind him as he pushes forward again.
And once again, that's an adaptation that we've seen around even since MSI, when Evelynn was a bit of an oddball kind of pocket
I
pick.
I will remember you.
One time, China won. Hold on to it. Hold it in your heart. But, and that's surprising not to see him adapt that way, but at the same time, if you're a more solo queue style player, that sort of strategy doesn't always occur to you, as Hippo is going to go down once again, Evelynn dishing out so much damage, and Gangplank just really did not stand a chance in that instance. The Runeglaive power spike is just too massive.
Yeah, and that's what I wanted to point out. It is 8 minutes in the game, and Doko is running around with a Runeglaive. That was huge burst damage out of this Evelynn. And again, Hippo, he's expending 200 gold now in these pink wards to ward behind him where it offers zero protection. Just put it in the river.
TP being burned out from Hippo as well, trying to recoup some of this farm. Already burned his ultimate. Really just suffering this game. We'll have flash up shortly, may be able to keep him safe, but Mimic is just continuing to scale up, building a massive CS advantage. Which we would be able to, there you go. 41-66 there in the top lane.
He just needs to keep the wave right here. You got it.
Solid wave control. He's starting to adapt to that matchup. I just fear that it may be too late for them. Kramer on the bottom side of the map with the Sheen should be able to start trading a little bit more effectively with Gap. So neither side seems too eager to engage the other. 19 doing a good job against this Vladimir, but not able to match the wave clear nearly as comfortably.
Has his tier, however, so starting to stack that up as well as the longsword. In a good position, Vladimir meanwhile on the other side with the Hextech Revolver as well as, and more importantly, level 8. So that much closer to the level 9 to have all 5 points in the queue.
Kramer actually getting kind of devastated in that trade. Mocha and Gap showing us some pretty impressive synergy. Callista going in for a small trade before immediately getting lantern out, denying that Sheen proc.
Exactly, and that's what I was going to point out, is the denial of the Sheen proc, so Corki's not able to get that big burst damage and losing these elongated trades, but here we go.
Coming in with the cutlass, the sustained damage is there for them. They're throwing in the thrash. They may find the kill on the Kramer. Spears are stacking up, but he made it out of the range. They're going to go in on to Nonstop. I don't think they're going to find anything else. He does have Unbreakable Will. He should be fine here. But some beautiful performances from the bot lane on the side of Pathos. Everything seems to be going their way. Beggar doing his best Hojin impression on the top side of the map.
And I really like how this is the automatic call to mosey on into this dragon. So again, you have the Callistus, you have the power of the Rim, but more importantly, you just won that bot lane trade. Did you get the kill? No, but you got the objective.
Really not sure what Beggar expects to happen on the top side of the map. Even if he hits a stun, the most he can hope for is an ultimate. Gangplank just does not have the raw damage at this stage of the game to burst down this Olaf. And it just feels like Young Boss are scrambling to find some sort of advantage and are clearly looking lost.
Pathos just frankly winning in the lanes at this point as well. The only one that's a little bit questionable is the mid lane, but 19's really just sitting back and throwing out cues. So give it time for this Vladimir to really ramp up and become that late game monster that he can.
Of course, already itemizing a decent amount of cooldown reduction. He'll be that much more comfortable to match Varus's early wave clear. Otherwise, coming after Varus as well, trying to keep up while the tier may be holding him back a little bit in terms of damage. It will eventually turn into that Muramana and offer a massive spike. at least in auto attack exchanges.
And this is the type of ward that Young Boss needs to transition onto Evelyn. You see the Krugs are warded, so Eve now has information of where Beggar is moving around on the map.
Not going to spot that pink ward either, so just knows exactly where Beggar is headed. And unfortunately, that just makes it so much easier for them to play forward. You can see Mimic not even remotely concerned. He even feels comfortable enough to dive to Gangplank. Gangplank not going to have it. Hippo picking up a decent amount of CS there, though. Despite being down 69 to 105, he will get back some of that gold.
And what that translates, although it's a little bit different for Gangplank just because of how his gold values with the minions interact, is for every 13 to 15 CS, it equates one kill worth of gold into your back pocket. So Olaf right now has the 2 assists as well as about 2 kill advantage over Hippo.
Hippo clearly aware that he is behind and needing to catch up, is invested in the bank plank strategy. Avarice Blade coming out for him as well. It's going to take a long time for him to get online, but it'll be slightly shorter. Just we'll have to wait on that Triforce a little bit.
The lane, see if Mocha can lead with a Descendants. In fact, really taking their time to posture and set this one up.
Neji in trouble, try to dive YB, not going to find the cocoon though, going in, getting aggressive, a lot of sustain coming in here. The arrow's going to come out and it will seal the deal, but in the bot lane, another one is going to drop. They find the kill, they find the hook. Unbreakable Will saving him in the end there. But Kramer getting burned out, a player with such a solid reputation in the LMS, getting dominated. Everyone dropping left and right on the side of Young Boss.
And it's the information. You know where both junglers are, so it gives Mimic the go-ahead to force that kind of dive into the top lane, as well as get the flash out of Gangplank.
And unfortunately for Young Boss, it looks like Mathos are just outclassing them on an individual level. Pushing forward, desperately trying to secure this turret. They're just going to be comfortable to back off here nonstop. Can't really do a whole lot to stop as we cut into this replay.
I thought for sure we're going to see the replay top, but here we go. Nice play. Mocha put in position by the Fate's Fall, able to find that follow-up CC to help the damage onto Evelyn, but really just really, really good posturing from Eve there, taking the time, going all the way around the tribe rush to put herself in perfect gank path.
And really, when we look at that play, Kramer had no hope outside of the peel from Nonstop, and Nonstop was just very late on the use of his abilities. We saw Unbreakable Will come out just before he was about to die, but long after Kramer had already passed. Could have used the Unbreakable Will, could have used the Headbutt Pulverize to protect his AD carry, but just seemed lost, did not expect the Evelyn in his lane, did not expect that flank to come out. Of course, Mimic still on the top side of the map, 75 to 125, trying to double his opponent's CS. I thought Duke was going to hit the Flame Horizon. Saying it one more time, give this one to me. It looks like Mimic may in this exchange. And Pager, unfortunately, can't even duel the Olaf at the stage of the game. It's just going to have to run away.
And this is the question. How will Mimic's lead and commanding dominance over the top side of the map transition into the rest of the map? Is he just going to continue to push Hippo in and draw resources from Young Boss top to allow his team to make plays beneath him? Or is he going to get involved in the mid lane with teleports into the bottom lane and try to snowball and fast push down the other tier 1 towers?
Mimic appears hungry for blood. He's posturing behind Varus in the mid lane. He's going to go in anyway. They're going to find this kill for sure.
Oh my god.
So much damage. Ragnarok not even utilized there as Mangchi drops tower aggro via the pool. And
Becky, look at that damage. That was absurd. That was like Faker in the mid lane.
God. Beggar also getting crushed out. Every member of Pathos looking for their glory moment.
Starting to become a bloodbath. They are just dominating every single lane individually, and now it's bot lane's turn.
Fate's Call going to be used. They're going to toss the Thresh in. The hook coming out. Kramer will sidestep that one nonstop. Finally pushing someone else under tower, but Mocha going to flash out to safety. Kramer will drop. Nonstop will drop, and Pathos 1-8 now with a almost 6K cold lead as they take down that tower.
And this train is not stopping. It started in the top lane, made its first stop in the mid lane, and then rolled right on through the bottom lane. That is the 1-2 punch, just the first tier mid tower left standing.
4-0-2, the scoreline for Dolgo here. Apps or Doko?
Doko.
Doko. Very impressive
player
overall.
It's like, don't go.
And the issue here is that he's now building tanky, But the Rune Glaive, because it's so early in the game, still provides an absurd amount of damage in his game.
Well, he's just level 10 Eve from the jungle. He hits Corki with a Sheen proc, and that guy's going to explode into shrapnel. He's just going to be like little tufts of mustache.
Poor Kramer came in, wanted to play the tournament, qualified well, and is now suffering at the hands of Pathos.
Welcome back to Korea.
Rough game for him. Easily going to secure this Baron with the power of Kalista while Mimic wanders back into the top lane to pick up some CS. 104 to 130. Gangplank has done an excellent job. Hippo catching up slowly but surely, but at what cost? The rest of the team appears to have died for Gangplank to catch up.
And again, this is just... oh, so sad.
Hippo, I'm sorry, buddy.
Pick up the axe.
Rest in peace.
Run, Hippo! Run!
What?
Oh, dodged it!
Got it, one more. No, stop. Started to spam dance. We didn't get to see the animation, but...
Well, fun fact about hippos, they actually kill more people than, like...
Anything else.
Yeah, yeah. Pretty much anything else, because they're devastating. But the problem is you have to, like, run into their mouths, because they have such strong jaw power. Mm. So I feel like, you know, hippo's time could come. You just need to be patient and, like, swim into the 45-minute Trinity Force double eye-edge completion... Gangplank. It's there. It's looming. But
the lethal hippo is waiting. The terror of... Oh, wow. 19 dodging out on that gank. May be able to get something back on the Zolgo. Has to back up here. The Gangplank call may get him to safety, and they will find a return kill, shutting down that Evelynn. And a little bit too aggressive. A fast reaction flash from 19 to kind of save his life and turn that one in his favor.
Cockiness. The MVP right now. Trying to dive those towers with low health and just not doing a good job juggling the aggro. We'll see if Pathos can show some restraint here, control their lead, funnel it appropriately, and continue to snowball this game, or if their maybe ego and over-eager plays will get the best of them as Young Boss transition this into a nice tower. JK. They got good poke.
Frozen the axes. Now, this is the big thing that separates LCK teams from Challenger teams. It separates LCS teams from Challenger teams in nearly every region is when you have a lead, can you snowball it? Can you win the game cleanly? Right now, Pathos appear to be winning on mechanical skill and jungle pathing, but if they can show some clever macro strategy, they may be able to advance comfortably to the round of eight, because right now, this is a dominating performance.
Surely this tower will go down. They need to watch out for Mocha.
Fresh hook on the side. Almost lost myself in that instance, but such a quick kill going over to Doko. Evelynn now 5-1-2.
There is a real issue, however, when you snowball a game this quickly, 2-10 right now, 27-33. It's still very difficult to push and siege down tier 2 towers just because you don't have the damage available to you yet. So we'll see how they maneuver around this problem. It looks like they are setting up for a push on the top side. So Mimic grabbing the wave. You got the deep vision down. We'll see if they go for a dive or if they're just going to continue to attempt to whittle.
It appears that Young Boss are ready to respond in this instance. They're sending over some coverage, sending over some wave clear onto this tower, but they have to be careful about which route they take. If they run face first into Doko, it could spell the end for them. Alts being burned left and right. The tower will be safe for Young Boss, at least for now.
Okay, so will they continue to be patient and try to beat Young Boss around the map and continue to whittle on these towers, abusing the dragon timers, knowing that Pathos can't fight them? Or are they just going to immediately go for the 20-minute Baron spawn, which is far riskier of a play, but with the Gangplank ultimate down and zero vision, looks like it's free.
And Kalista, of course, a reliable way to 100% secure this. They are going to get it. Can't stop going in. For what I guess is the steal attempt, as Kramer is on the backside. Mimic is most likely going to go down here. He will drop. And every member of Pathos is in trouble. Vladimir all coming out though. Mangji doing so much damage. Hippo finally able to do something, but Kramer could be in trouble as well. May try to get aggressive. They have to be careful. Doko,
just run at him.
At any moment could speed up and go in. Bar Zero coming over the wall. Gonna find the kill. The quick
headshot.
Snipe. 19 taking that one down, but Doko could find the 2v1 here. 19 trying to find something, moving in two blight stacks, three blight stacks. The arrow has to be available. Charging it up, we'll see the flash to get out of there. 19 still on the hunt. Another few seconds until the arrow is available. It's unlikely he's going to get this. Turning his attention toward the creep wave as the tower goes down in the mid lane, and the gold starts to swing back in the favor of Young Boss.
One Baron buff left on Evelynn right there. That was two steps forward, one step back.
Mimic going in onto 19 here. There's almost nothing that this Varus can do. One axe hits, two axe hits, the reckless swing, and a death sentence for Varus. As 19 drops to Mimic, this is one unstoppable Olaf finishing up the Steryx gauge, but Kramer will find something back on the bottom side of the map.
Okay, so minimizing the gold lead a bit, still 33-39. Pathos are still well in control, but I think this just goes back to the idea that when you're ahead, how do you retain the snowball? How do you close out the game? They went for the really high risk, I want to say high risk, kind of medium reward play. By taking the Baron. I would have rather seen a team, you know, set up deep vision, use the fact that they are ahead through their items, through their gold lead, to contest smaller objectives, you know, contest the red, the blue, make them fight the dragon, slowly whittle down on the towers, because I feel like, you know, they got the Baron, they got the global gold, but two steps forward, one step back.
That's fair. I mean, in their defense, have you ever been 7-1 on Eve? You
just feel the power.
You feel the need to go in relentlessly, and I think that's exactly what's happening here. Pathos want to fight. They want to cement this game. They're eager to find a win here, maybe over-eager, as you're saying, as they've adapted less than ideal strategies, not willing to slowly choke their opponents out. Next dragon going down. If they find this third one, we'll give them a decent move and speed boost. They pick even easier. Posturing around the outside. The arrow can out-damage his might, but it could not out-damage Callisto.
I was going to say, Callisto's already got her.
Ooh, yeah. Oh! Trouble, Death's Daughter doing so much damage. Doko going to secure that one, but there is no follow-up. Vladimir in the back line, picking up a double kill, a beautiful flank, and Mimic. No one left to stop him from taking down Hippo. Despite putting himself right in the Hippo's mouth, nothing is going to happen. He is too far behind, and true damage, ignoring Alistair's ultimate. Unbreakable Will, quite easily broken by Mimic's Olaf.
Mimic and Manchi just destroyed that fight. These two champions are so far ahead. Vladimir just dropping aggro on the tower. He doesn't care. Meanwhile, in the mid lane. And it was such a beautiful Gangplank ult, too. I feel like Gangplank is almost the new Rumble when it comes to dragon control, just because the surface area that his ultimate covers and how much damage it does, it's perfect for fighting. I mean, just look at this. Gangplank ultimate's actually going to come down on Gap, and it's going to force him out of Rend, because it just is doing so much damage on the backline. But despite the fact that this is such a great fight for Young Boss, because this is effectively a 2v3, 2v4, these two champions are just too far ahead.
It's an unfortunate circumstance for Young Boss in that exchange. They needed to find this much earlier. Now that they are so far behind, anything short of an absolutely perfect fight in their favor.
Well, this is also, you know, where they have their power breaks, where they get strong, having the Trinity Force on the Corki as well as the Gangplank, having the Last Whisper, the Muromana, complete on Varus.
Finding the hook onto 19, going in, bringing in Callista on the backside. She's not going to take the Lantern, but he will take Livy's life. Gap secures that one. Doko picking up one for himself. The kill's being spread around the team liberally because he's pretty much getting them all for free at this stage of the game. Young Boss getting dominated here, at least thinking she may find a way to safety, but it's just a different path to death. Pathos absolutely dominating this game. Young Boss showing sparks of intelligence, sparks of individual skill, but just not enough to battle the burning fire that is Pathos.
They're just way too far ahead. I mean, that said, Najin misplayed closely when they had a massive lead, so we'll see if Pathos react in a similar fashion, but right now just far too oppressive and far too many damage threats. The fact that even if you finally do take down Mimic, which will be impressive all on its own, you still have to go through Vladimir. Eve is still massive, and then there's Callista, the actual AD carry, so you have pretty much a quadruple damage threat team coming out of Pathos.
And additionally, look at the damage sources coming in from this team. Elise, really the only reliable source of magic damage. Corki has a small amount. Varus has his blight stacks, but outside of that,
Corki does more magic damage than physical.
Rip. Can he burn through a Steryx gauge, a Black Cleaver, and a Dreadman?
No, he'll run for his life.
Exactly. And that's the issue as we move forward, is that Olaf is so comfortable to itemize armor and health, getting magic resist as well at the stage of the game, and that Dreadman's play, or that Dead Man's play, is just going to make it impossible to get away from him, as if it wasn't hard enough already. Because the mobile carries such as Varus, just not even concerned. 19 burning heal to try to get out of there, but it's just not going to be enough. He's getting burned down. Mimic grabbing one more for himself. 6-1-9, and unfortunately, this has been the story of the game. Mimic and the rest of Peyto's just running through the opposition as they will secure their first inhibitor and potentially the game as they move in for the fight here. Alistar burning the Unbreakable Will. They may throw the rest back in with the Fates Call. They're going to throw him out, use the lantern to secure gap, not wanting to get too aggressive. They've learned from their earlier mistakes at the Baron pick.
Take the mid inhibitor. Baron will be spawning in 35 seconds. It's just a question of, are they going to back and reset their waves and buy, or just walking immediately to the Baron and wait?
Looks like they're just going to set up vision. They're confident in their strength. They don't think they need any more itemization spikes. Doko going back may indicate that they're going to be a little bit more patient. Mimic's just hungry for blood, though. Ward's being thrown out left and right. He is ready at any moment to make a pick.
They're all just pressuring the waves forward, spending their last amount of gold, and they'll meet on this Baron, probably set up around a corner, see if the enemy team's going to dare to face Sheck. If so, get a pick. But otherwise, this is just the free purple worm.
It's been a long time where a team has been so far ahead that I've heard someone make the statement, free purple worm.
Absolutely free.
It's definitely free. And at this point, when you have a Kalista, an Olaf, every single member of the team is fed. It's not even Baron Nashor anymore. It's just a big purple worm. And it's dropping so quickly as Gap will surely secure this one with the Ren. Nope, giving it over to Doko. Prove those last hitting statistics for major objectives.
Yeah, we'll say it's giving it over.
Not missing it, no.
They don't do that. They don't do that on the world stage.
Moving forward, Baron buff and powered Superman.
It's a kid joke.
Gap just not even remotely concerned. So much lifesteal in his current itemization that he is just able to walk up freely and auto-attack the turret. Every member of Mathos just seems content to split up and push out side lanes. There's really no need for them to group, and they have a lot of flexibility to get in and get out. There just isn't the damage on the side of Young Boss to kill anyone. TP coming in for Mimic. Mimic is hungry for blood here, and I think he might find some, or at least the tower pushing in has bought the elixir. Doggo going in. They use the Fates Call. They're going to find that. Varus trying to disengage with the chains or corruption, but it is not going to be enough. Mimic backing off using the heal movement speed to help secure that inhibitor. It's Minji's team. Just turn to go deep.
It is chaos. It is destruction. It is absolute dominance coming out of Peyto's here for game one. And the question is now, what do Young Boss change to try to make a comeback in this series?
They are able to pick up some kills. It is just a brief respite. They will find themselves taken out so very quickly. And I'm not sure what the answer is when it's such a crushing win. What do you ban? What do you take away? What do you change? Make your team play more proficiently, because every single lane was beaten out in this game.
I mean, you're absolutely right. Big picks that are standing out to me are Mimic on that Olaf, but I mean, the likes of Fiora were still up and available. If he's that dominating on Olaf, I can only suspect that he's dominating on the other Terry-esque champions. So we'll see how shallow some of their champion pools are, or if it really was, you know, bands like Master Yi that set this up.
I'll be curious to see what happens if those champions make it through. I mean, Young Boss just, they were a team that was definitely hyped coming into this matchup, and I just did not appreciate how strong Peyto's were on an individual level. Their duo bot, so much strength, so comfortable on that Kalista Thresh. And additionally, Doko, as a caster, I do a lot of color casting, and when I see Evelynn, I'm always skeptical. She's not a champion I enjoy. I much prefer hard CC, but when you have a performance like that, I just have to shut up and take a step back, because clearly Evelynn is doing work, and it was an excellent pick for them in that game.
You know, normally I actually really agree with you. The fact that typically with Eve, you see tandem with taking hard CC into your solo lanes to offer her more kill pressure, but you can think her solo lanes were Vladimir and Olaf. So just taking the raw damage and finding the snowball, transitioning that into the Runeglaive, and really running away with it.
And once again, I'm just not exactly sure what they're going to have to do to adapt, but they will have a few minutes to think about it as we push for a five-minute break. Don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be back with game two between Pathos and Young Boss.
동맹에 참여하라. 그리고 세계를 정복하라. 게임 오브 워. 지금 무료로 다운받으세요.
LTE 시대, 놀랄 만큼 속도가 빨라졌습니다. 그런데 말입니다. 놀랄 만큼 요금도 비싸졌습니다.
LTE 통신비, 대안을 찾자. 헬로 모바일 다이렉트. 동영상 하나 여는 게 지갑 여는 것 같습니까? 음악을 듣는데 데이터 떨어지는 소리가 들립니까? LTE 통신비, 대안을 찾자. 헬로 모바일 다이렉트.
편의점 택배구만. 에? 15년 됐다지. 오. 싸지, 가깝지, 잘 가지. 편하더구만. 우리 얘기하는 대충.
인터넷 예약하면 더 편해요. 시유에서
보내시유.
만 볼 것인가? Save the world. 힛.
이연복. 그가 만든 짜장면도 가루 스프를 뿌리면 라면이 됩니다.
이래야 진짜 짜장이죠.
라면이 아니다. 짜장면이다.
발도 짜장면.
자, 일단 돌려주고.
자, 이제 안 맞습니다. 맞네요. 맞고 궁중 판정이 아닌가요?
자, 한번 더.
한 번 더.
자, 상태.
레이저 맞히고.
레이저 맞힐 때 레이저 앞장.
버킹 로우랑 엘보 이제 강제로 걸려야 돼요.
자,
로우랑 엘보를 맞습니다.
자, 아, 와, 페이스가 모으는데요?
이거 완전히 말렸는데요? 자, 시크릿.
또 이러면 막 버큰걸 때리면
퍼펙트죠.
이번 라운드도 퍼펙트로,
마무리됩니다.
시크릿이 우승!
정말 쟁쟁하신 분들이 많이 올라오셨는데 어떻게 제가 마지막까지 그냥 포기 안 하고 하자는 생각밖에 없었는데 어떻게 지고 있는 상황에서도 잘 역전 같은 것도 좀 많았던 것 같고 좀 제가 생각했던 대로 잘 준비한 대로 그대로 돼가지고 그게 되게 좋았던 것 같습니다. 이번에 안주하지 않고 더 지금보다 준비를 더 체계적으로 하고 또 일본에 있는 유저들의 영상도 많이 봐서 이제 좀 파악도 많이 한 다음에 확실하게 준비를 해서 일본을 갈 생각입니다. 한국 철권에 자존심을 걸고 꼭 반드시 우승하고 돌아오겠습니다. 화이팅!
First game, we'll have to see if they can keep that going as we head into the picks and bans of game two. Now, we talked a little bit, we're not sure exactly what Young Boss is going to have to adjust, what needs to change, but Peyto's looking very dominant in their first Kespa Cup performance, their first game in Kespa Cup, showing up huge, everyone on that team with a fantastic scoreline.
Particularly huge Stenets to mimic, in my opinion, looked fantastic. Yeah, he was snowballed by Eve that game around, so see if he needs that jungle pressure to take off, or if he can continue to be a dominating force, and if that Olaf hit will be taken away.
And if you take away the Olaf, what else is in this guy's champion pool? We don't know as much about these players. Kramer in the bottom lane, picking up that Corki. I think that's one thing that has to change. I know Kramer is an Ezreal player, a Vayne player. And the Corki just was not doing it that time around, was not able to have a huge impact in the mid game, as Corki usually does. And it seems like the poke comp that seemed so well crafted in pick and bans just was not well executed in the actual game.
No, I completely agree, but this time around they have a second chance in draft phase. Remember, it is game set point for Pathos and the Master Yi ban again.
Not giving Young Boss a chance to run away with the game.
Literally.
19, evidently, mid lane player. Twisted Fate also going to get banned out here once again, taken away. The Vladimir was incredibly effective in SR Champion. We see a lot, but it seems that the story of these two teams is going to be the mid lane ban focus. Wondering if we're going to see any attention paid toward the top lane, though.
Again, back-to-back target bans, and when you have teams from the Challenger circuit, this tends to be the MO, is find a player, limit their champion pool, profit.
Just talk about NL or Kramer playing that vein. It does look like it's going to get taken away. I love Kramer's vein. He builds weird things, builds a Wit's End. Kindred also taken off the table, so a lot of that percentage health damage taken away on both sides. What is the first pick you think going to be here? Ryze is still on the table.
They didn't pick it last game.
Kalista. That's a powerhouse. We've seen what that bot lane can do with the Kalista Thresh. I wonder if they'll try to take away the Thresh here on the side of Young Boss or what they're going to pick to deal with this. Corki was clearly not the answer. There are still a lot of power picks on the table. Ryze, as we talked about, Veigar as well. No one wants to pick up Ryze. Interesting to see Tahm Kench. Quite a long list of power picks in the current meta, but maybe not comfort picks for the players.
The scary thing is, this is what I'm going to say. If they pick up Thresh in second rotation to deny it from Mocha so he can't pair up with Kalista again, there's always the option of Tahm Kench, which also has insane synergy with Kalista.
Agreed. We've seen what exactly you can do when you just throw the Tahm Kench forward or pull the Tahm Kench back when he's got somebody inside of his belly. A massive amount of displacement in a very easy way of lane. Very similar lane setup overall, but it looks like it's going to be the Alistar support locked in and the Elise to match up against the Gragas on Young Boss. Interesting to see what Doko does with this pick.
Obviously had a great performance on Eve last game. Elise is going to offer more tools for initial ganks with the cocoon. Obviously the change there being that she only is afforded to put 1 point in her cocoon and not lose any of the duration of the CC. It's been a long day. Where's the Novocaine?
Now it's coming back. Of course, these guys though have been making these games pretty quick. We'll have to see if Young Boss can turn this one on his head, although I'm not sure. Obviously their pick is up. They've got two champions to lock in. I'm wondering who they're going to save this last pick priority for. Maybe best to give it over to Hippo after he was absolutely dominant in the top lane matchup, but it looks like they're going to save it for the mid lane. Gnar and Sivir, the next two lock-ins. This is a very comp reminiscent of earlier patches, but one that we've seen be very effective.
This is the all-engage wombo combo. Now, the thing that Papa Smithy likes to point out is that Gnar and Gragas have pretty much anti-synergy. If you think about it, Gragas wants to separate everyone with his displacement on the ultimate cast, whereas Gnar wants everyone grouped up so he can find the CC lock wombo combo into a wall. So see if they're able to communicate that effectively or if it's every man for himself. And speaking of every man for himself, Mimic's on Olaf.
Mimic. Trying to see if Hippo has anything to deal with this, and I'm just wondering what Hippo can bust out here. Mimic was such a proficient Olaf player.
I don't think it's going to be Gangplank.
In the mid lane, of course, Victor getting picked up, though. Very much safer mid laner overall. Oh, Gnar's already locked in. So it's the Gnar versus Olaf matchup, and I'm thinking that Mimic is just so comfortable on this Olaf that he sees no reason to change it up, although Gnar's range may let him trade comfortably, at least pre-level 6.
I mean, it's not a big deal for Olaf. If he really wants to, he can use the brush for cover in terms of dropping aggro and vision, and then just continuously throw around his cooldown on Q, tag with the axes, poke and run down. It's an easier lane for Gnar, you are correct there. But here we go, finally.
Veigar, of course, an excellent champion for CG. Excellent scaling into the late game, but on 5.1, those base damages were nerfed. So while he was still gaining an immense amount of AP from the passive on his Q, that Baleful Strike, he will not have insane damage on that Dark Matter anymore. still very strong, but a little bit toned down may help the Victor matchup overall. Victor and Veigar, very similar champions in what they do.
Yeah, and they also have great siege potential. If you think about, again, approaching a tower, setting down the baby cage, setting down the gravitational field, and zoning people off. Now, the thing that's really interesting specifically for Victor into Veigar is Victor has one of the most creative itemizations of any mid laner right now. And just in terms of how he can build and where he's going to flex his allies or not, which impacts Veigar for how his passive does damage, because Victor doesn't need to stack straight.
Now, the real question for me is, how is this early game going to go? Because while we can speculate at the late game, it's been all about the early game, and may continue to be all about the early game, and we'll get into that early game in just a moment. Game two, Young Boss, Pathos, don't go anywhere.
Now, for those of you who don't know, Sifa, Daniel Sifa Dracos, actually has some mad rap skills.
Oh my god, no.
And I feel like if we're in a game with someone named Young Boss,
no.
There is no other time to debut your rap career.
No. Listen, there's nothing I would want more, but I got really distracted as we came into Champion Select because all of Young Boss has Flash Wolves logos, and that absolutely blew my mind.
To debut his rap career.
No.
No, we're game two. It's Young Boss versus Pathos. This is game, set, and match for Pathos. If they win here, they continue on. If they lose, Young Boss could look to make a comeback into game three, but it did not look good in the first game. See if it looks better as we have a standard 5 point, and I'm still waiting for some sick rhymes.
No sick rhymes.
You're such a party pooper.
I'm holding back. Gotta save it for the finals.
Do you trust me?
Oh, no. No Disney. No. Okay. We're losing it as we move further into the day. These matchups become more and more intense for these guys. But Pathos must be pretty comfortable after that first win. Maybe need to make sure, though, that they stay tight on the play, that they continue to be as aggressive and proactive as they were in game one. Because if they are, they can move on to the round eight quite easily.
Yeah, and Young Boss actually attempting a lane swap here. So going to completely sidestep the Kalista and the Alistar. Moseying up through the top lane. We do have nonstop very deep into the river, setting a late ward to make sure that no one's getting delayed and baited on. See how they're going to treat this. Obviously, Sivir has more pushing potential should she choose to go for a fast push versus a freeze than Kalista.
It'll be interesting to see exactly what Pathos do around this. Nonstop is in trouble here, though, as Olaf is going to keep running forward. Not enough of a mana pool to chase too far, but they have to be careful. It is going to reset the camp, and that's pretty massive. Gnar coming over from the side. Hippo will have that boomerang to start. Gragas is there as well. Mimic could be in trouble. Shutting down Mimic early could be the key to taking this to game three. And already Young Boss off to a much better start.
Yeah, beautifully played, although Mocha has roamed over. Now Mimic is out of the play. He does have teleport available, so now full health. We'll see if he commits on the teleport, tries to get involved. Here he comes.
Coming in.
Oh!
Flash! Pulverize going to offer so much. They're not going to find anything else, though. Mocha trying to get something. Hippo could be in trouble. Looking for the repeat performance. Not going to find it. The heal coming out. A game of inches here. Will anyone go down nonstop? Sure to fall here. Olaf grabbing one.
Double.
Elise grabbing the second. And Pathos look to be falling behind, but turn that one on its head. A beautiful flash pulverize from Mocha.
And we were just complimenting Young Boss. This looks so much better. You know, initiate the lane swap. Take the wheel of the macro play. Put yourself in the driver's seat. They stay too long in the blue buff, get punished by a beautiful teleport, and once again, Mimic is looking to run away with this game.
And meanwhile, on the bot lane, Gap is farming up a decent advantage, 18 to 10. One of the couple will get an immense amount of experience as Dolgo pushes into the jungle and Pathos owns the top side of the map. They are going to move towards the Sivir. Has to be careful. That is a level one thresh, very vulnerable. They do have vision on this, and they go in, blocking the first act, and there will be another
spell shield.
The stun could come in. The spider's going to come out. Not a whole lot of damage there, though.
Her reprieve was the fact that Mocha is only level 1, so he doesn't have the combo. And likewise, Dogo is level 2, so he doesn't have the cocoon. So there wasn't the hard CC to follow up, so it was okay to burn the spell shield to dodge the slow on the axe. So great performance from Kramer right there.
Good patience from Kramer. He's been pressured out a lot in the LMS. No surprise to see it repeated here in the Kasper Cup.
Neighbor Kasper Cup.
Of course, yeah. Huge shout-outs to Neighbor, guys. If you,
what are our other sponsors, Sifa?
Well, if you're not able to watch on Azubu, you should check out Neighbor's new app, V. It is a video streaming app available on iOS and on Android, which will not only allow you to watch both the English and Korean broadcast of this tournament on your mobile device, but additionally will allow you to connect with your favorite professional players and see sweet food selfies, because, you know.
Yum broccoli.
Broccoli. Got it. Also Azubu and Longsword.
Meanwhile, in the mid lane.
Of course, this matchup...
Pushing minions.
Yeah, looking pretty even so far, but at the end of the day, we have to give the scaling advantage to Veigar. As always, Baleful Strike, just such a powerful ability.
Again, these champions do very similar things in terms of how they control terrain. I like to call Victor the AP Jarvan in terms of controlling with your massive cataclysm. In Victor's terms, it's your Chaos Storm and your Gravitational Field. You just grab a choke point, you just cause death and destruction. Veigar, very similar. He's going to throw down his little cage, the Thunderdome, if you will. Speaking of Thunderdome...
We're going to put Hippo in the Thunderdome as they push down, but the last few seconds of that ward will let him know what's coming. Dolgo and Mocha not going to push too far. Don't have vision of the Gnar at this stage. They're just going to back off here. So a well-placed ward from Hippo will keep him alive, playing a lot more cautiously after being dominated in the previous game by Mimic. And Mimic still with a decent CS advantage here on the top side of the map.
You know, we've committed so hard to his name being Hippo, but it technically doesn't have two P's. It could be Hypo.
Hippo.
I'm just saying.
It's Hippo. We committed.
He's super cute.
It's perfect.
Yeah, he's only got 19 CS, 2 Mimics, 30 right now, though. Likewise, level 4 to level 5, so there will be the discrepancy between when Olaf's going to get his ultimate run head first at him.
And additionally, Olaf does have the ghost, whereas Gnar will not have the flash for at least another minute and a half.
He's got his hippity hop. That's what hippos do, right?
Could be in trouble. We've seen a repeat of a gank we saw earlier today already.
Manchi
very much in trouble. Is going to be able to make it out here. One more Baleful Strike will not come out and is going to survive the Thunderdome being traded for the Gravity Field. And everything works out in his favor.
What a cool interaction, right? I'm not even going to call it an interaction, but a counterplay. So the baby cage goes down the event horizon there from 19, and he immediately drops the gravitational field, which pretty much fits perfectly inside the event horizon. So it's like, I dare you. As long as he doesn't hit the stun and eat the W, he was totally fine. So great thinking there. I was really impressed with that.
I'm not going out, but you are sure as hell not coming in.
I was just
going
to say that.
Finds his way to safety.
You're stuck in here with me.
Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, a decent farm advantage. Going over to Gap on that Kalista. We've seen exactly how proficient he can be, but a 10 CS lead developing this early. It's a worrying sign.
A worrying trend.
Yeah, I was trying to avoid it.
Well,
I was
so
trying.
That was actually a reflex. That was bad.
Yeah. Talk about color or something.
Early itemization coming out. So Kramer obviously getting ganked early was forced into an early recall. Wasn't able to stick it out for his BF sword. Has come back with a pickaxe. So we'll see where Gap chooses to itemize. If he's going to go for the cutlass, which is fairly common on Kalista, or if he possibly goes for the lifesteal, possibly a bloodthirster rush. It's the cutlass, by the way. Spoiler alert.
Cutlass wants to have a little bit more auto attack speed to be able to match Sivir's early wave pressure. Kramer previously was able to go back and buy those 5-4 pieces, had to wait to get that scaling up, as we see another Venn diagram, an exchange of CC control zones in the mid lane, and Elise now heading up to clear the jungle as well. So overall, a much more passive game in game one, the first two kills in the jungle, the only ones we've seen so far. It'll be interesting to see how these teams adapt without these incredibly quick victories in the early laning phase.
I feel like Hippo has really learned his lesson. So yeah, it's a much less bloody game, but this is still kind of indicative of what Paythos have shown us in game one. So you have Doko making really aggressive, deep warding plays, looking to focus and bounce between mid and top lane. But Hippo is refusing to overcommit as he did in the first game. So a good adaptation from Hippo to reel in his feeding.
Wow.
I mean, in your defense, obviously, Hippo had a very poor performance in the previous game.
He overextended continuously. He's got much better vision this time around. Again, being much more responsible in how he postures in his lane and where he extends.
And once again, this is the big difference, is these teams don't have too much information about each other, so Hippo, maybe a little bit more confident, stepped into lane against Mimic, realized that he was not the stronger laner, and now in game two has gained a lot more respect, is playing a lot more safely, and at least adapting to a certain degree at this point in the game. Previously, Kaitos had a massive lead. They still have a decent-sized one just from CS and those early two kills, but not nearly as large, and we'll have to see if they can continue to snowball it as they did in the previous match.
CS discrepancies pretty much across the board in every lane, but that mid one, Victor, down about 10 CS, although he's got a wave pushing into him. But big thing is actually the 80 carries.
85 to 76.
More importantly, the fact that Kramer has itemized into the Avarice Blade with the pickaxe. So again, his recalls got a little bit funky. It's not awful on Sivir. It's actually fairly standard simply because she's so good at farming that she's going to get a lot of the Avarice Blade. But if Pathos want to, they can try to pressure for Dragon Control or a skirmish on the bottom side of the map and take advantage of their itemization.
Now, in the past, Pathos has taken advantage of major map mispositions, but we haven't really seen them take advantage of power spikes. It's not in a major way. We'll have to see if they do so this time around. Of course, a difference in itemization to the junglers. Much more aggressive from Zoko, going along with Identity, whereas Beggar, who's currently waiting in the wings, went for that early Sight Stone, trying to provide some vision, trying to mitigate the early pressure that Zoko was able to put out in game one.
Whereas you have the burst potential from the Runeglaive Elise, sneaking into the back of this lane here. Here we go.
Finding the flash, pulverized, knocking back nonstop this Thresh, not looking like he has any way out of this fight. Olaf coming in as well. Mimic going to secure that kill. The TP going to get canceled. 19 realizing he wanted no part of that. We'll get some AP here in exchange, but a dominating fight from Pathos.
And this is what we were talking about, the fact that you had the item mismatch between Kalista and Sivir currently just because Kramer's backs got messed up. What is that transitioning to? A skirmish in the bot lane, because that's where your item disadvantage is. You then translate that into a free objective on the dragon. So a great one to punch. And Pathos, it's not super high level, but you know, showing that they understand their item breakpoints and how to capitalize on it.
As you said, expect to use of those items. Picking up the dragon as well, and now looking to find something onto Beggar. The headbutt pulverize onto the creep. The chain stun, is it going to be enough? Frozen back in with the Fate's Call. The lantern tossed at the body, not going to be enough. Will secure his friend's soul, but nothing else.
Like a ping pong ball, he was just bounced around there. Great chain CC, and again, because they now have the jungler, there's no support here for this mid lane turret, so another free objective.
Hippo desperately trying to recoup in the top lane. We've seen him do this exact same thing in game one where his team has to sacrifice so much, but he does recoup a little bit. This beautiful play right here, as you said, the chain CC, Fate's Call bringing it back, throwing him back in, securing this
the
just
yo-yo
so that he can get off the rend. Beautiful performance. And Mimic was waiting off to the side too. Pathos, when they commit to a gank, they really commit.
The communication was beautiful on that.
Of course, Gap now 1-0-1. We'll be able to back off, most likely able to finish that Blade of the Rune King on the next back. A pretty major power spike. Meanwhile, Olaf sticking with this early Kindle Gem, getting a lot of early cooldown reduction as well as health just to trade a little bit more effectively. And overall, starting to look exactly like game one. Pathos snowballing once again to only 12 minutes in, and we have a 3K gold lead.
Look at their vision control, although nonstop finds Elise, or does Elise find nonstop?
Could be in trouble. Beggar gonna move into support there. Thresh has to be happy to get his teammates, or he may have gone down there in the solo exchange. They will be able to find this tower, which will make up for a decent amount of the gold. However, still maintaining a 3K in the favor as Mimic takes another tower down in the top.
Something I wanted to point out was just the absurd amount of vision priority from Pathos. Look at the wards lighting up the entire offensive side of the jungle. They have complete control here. Now, the issue is that you have so many wards placed. That's a lot of gold that's been expended. What do they do with this gold that they put out?
Mimic is going to walk in circles around the jungle. Appears to be the current plan. Just waiting for an opportunity.
I think
to
he's
going to
dive. But that's not a good idea.
We've seen this before. They like these over-aggressive dives. They're happy to take these risks, even if they're not always the best choice. Thresh is waiting. They're bringing everyone in. Baby K is going to keep Mimic contained as Dogo could be in trouble. Going to drop down onto Beggar, but will get locked up and knocked out by Kramer.
Gnar coming in on the back, trying to use that on the hunt to get something. Boomerang going to slow out Mangji. Going to use the flash, an excellent flash to get himself out safely via the explosive pass. Saving the Ragnarok for good timing as Nonstop is finally able to land that hook, but it's just not enough.
Good counterplay from young boss right there to find something. That said, they effectively trade their jungler's life for the objective on the bottom. So Pathos continuing to play an objective-oriented game despite their really aggressive plays. Mimic was actually perfect on managing his ultimate cooldown right there. He wasn't scared. He didn't blow it early when the baby cage came down. Gotta stop it. When the Event Horizon came down, locking him in, he just stood patiently in the middle, and he was able to have that cooldown when the Destinies connected underneath his tower.
Which is going to be so crucial in those moments. Patience, of course, on a, and a, you know, an ultimate like that is absolutely everything in those life or death moments. Just going to push out this mid lane, keeping up with Veigar, although Veigar will, of course, outscale via the AP on the Baleful Strike. Not sure how much he's earned so far, but
this is the thing. Like, I understand what you're saying. Veigar is a late-game threat, and he has the potential to just blow someone up. But again, the itemization that can come out of Victor is very different than just, like, a flat AP mage, where Veigar is really going to get, like, his full potential and burst out of. So I feel like it's still a decent damage output, but it could be worse.
And definitely something we're going to have to look out for. We'll see how that matchup develops as we move forward. Hippo playing a lot more confidently now that he has that Black Cleaver, a little bit more mobility under his belt. Mimic has not had the opportunity to back off and buy his quite yet. Instead of getting the ninja dab with the home guard's upgrade. He's proven to us in the past that he really loves to flank. And the next question is, where will Pathos put their pressure right now? Winning lanes across the board.
Looks like they're trying to plan a dive here. Nonstop is shadowing underneath, getting some deep visions. Not going to commit with it simply because Beggar isn't in position yet. He's slowly moving over.
Turning up vision as he moves in. Nonstop may have to back off this one. May have spotted out Joker in here.
They don't have enough control because they don't see Alistar or Kalista.
Kalista, in the meantime, of course, going to be split pushing. Sivir will be easily able to clear out those waves, but has to be careful because an Alistar-Kalista combo could dive her under the turret at a moment's notice. Sivir simply, one spell shield is not enough to stop the Fate's Call and the Pulverize.
And Pathos have all of the information to make these aggressive plays should they want to. Again, look at the vision. That entire jungle is lit up.
And this is something that it seems like they're adapting to how to snowball, and they know that this is what they want to do. They're liking these picks. He's going to have to use the ultimate here. Excellent timing. Reaction to the cast animation from the Gnar ultimate running. The axe is going to fall just short, but a flash exchanged for a ghost and an ultimate for an ultimate. An even trade overall, though Olaf will find an advantage in the pressure, as well as a 30 CS lead.
Mimic is looking very impressive this series so far against the likes of Hippo. See if that translates over. Should Pathos continue forward against other LCK top laners?
Safe. Might be in trouble here. Fate's Call still available to save him if he gets out. Yeah. Not going to commit on it. Just not worth committing on the Alistar. And now Pathos are just going to take this dragon.
It was a misposture of the Event Horizon. But here we go. Teleport coming in.
Mimic determined to find something, going in with the home guards.
Just rotate mid. You've got the positional advantage on them. Although, actually, they're going to get to that. I thought the wave was pushing forward. Never mind. They're going to get there just fine.
Nothing really gained there outside of the dragon, but that is the second dragon, which make it that much easier for Pathos to take down the turrets in any future fight if they ever find an advantage. Another advantage, I should say. 4-1 the scoreline overall, 28.7 to 24.0. A almost 5k gold lead at this stage of the game is nearly unheard of outside of the just previous game. It seems to be the trend.
Much more controlled pace. It hasn't gotten snowballed as heavily as it has. That said, Pathos still managing to keep their gold lead, but acquiring it in very different ways, which is actually really promising coming from a Korean challenger team like this. The fact that they don't just need to win lane, win game, that it's through the careful management of fast pushing, reacting better to the lane swap, and frankly, reacting better to the level one through adaptation.
Overall, starting to show signs of growth even within this series. Looking solid for a challenger team overall. Chunam Technical University, the team
or the university that I believe all these players go to, Paphos Chinook University. Has to be proud. Some excellent performances here, doing very well in the round of 12, doing well to qualify, and doing even better here on this stage.
How far do they need to go to qualify for Busan, Daniel?
Qualify for Busan, they need to make it to the round of 4, which means not only will they need to win out here, but they will need to win another best of 3 against any of the other teams who went out in these best of 3s. Potentially a team like SK Telecom, Anarchy, or KT Rolster. So, definitely an uphill battle, but they have a brief respite here as Young Boss just has not been pressuring them too much.
Although Young Boss looking to apply some pressure here, as again, we have posturing for a tower dive, but a great shadow in response from Paphos. Elise sitting in the river waiting for something to happen.
It looks like Paphos more than happy to just wait this one out, slowly pushing in lanes, looking for vision control, looking for a pick, not getting too greedy. They learned in their previous match after an over-aggressive Baron attempt.
Well, Baron isn't on the map yet, so they could still go for the 20-minute Baron.
You might be right. Mocha appears to be going in here, may look for a play. The team is all pushing into the jungle. Doko gonna take this one away if he can. Will do so quite easily. Youngboss just backing off, not even remotely interested in contesting that objective. Vager looking for the explosive cast, looking for the pick, also not going to find it. So a free red buff going over to the side of Paphos.
I really love Elise as a pick into Thresh, and we saw what Doko was doing there as the reason, and it's simply when Thresh looks for the death sentence to change into spider form, to use your spiderlings as a body block for some hard CC.
19 could be in trouble here as Mimic runs forward. Mimic not that greedy though, can't run into the entire team of Young Boss. Hippo, of course, once again making sure that Mimic is punished for playing so aggressively in the mid lane. Will get that tower, will recoup some of the gold loss, keeping it at only 5k. Obviously still a massive deficit, but it could always get bigger, so Young Boss doing everything they can to stay in this game.
It's now just a matter of how patient are Paphos going to be, and when will they pull the trigger on the Baron? Again, they do have the Kalista composition, so they have the power of the Rend to secure that objective. It had mixed results for them last game, but didn't really matter in the scheme of things due to their snowball. And I kind of suspect that since the Dragon Timer is nowhere near quite yet, that they're going to make use of their deep vision wards on the top side of the jungle and start playing around that objective.
Olaf pushing on the top side of the map may indicate just that. They push forward nonstop, trying to get some of this vision back alongside Vager. They're jungling a little bit together just because they know how vulnerable they could be.
Here they go.
Now it looks like the Baron attempt once again could come out here, putting out a little bit of vision, potentially trying to bait Young Boss into getting too aggressive, although they will spot just the corner of Alistair's model as he moves in, and the pink ward will get cleared out by Mimic as well. So
as long as they're not overzealous here, this is a fine position to be in, because effectively they want Young Boss to fight them, or they want Young Boss to give them free objectives. So they're not losing anything here. If they don't want to take the high risk, low reward of tanking the Baron and fighting Young Boss, then they're just effectively waiting and posturing on the Baron as bait for that Dragon Timer. So either way, Paphos are in complete control of this game. As soon as that dragon is live, they'll probably just shift their focus over to the bottom side of the map, but they should just continue to dance around Baron and just kind of bait Young Boss into them. If they catch them, it's game over.
Mimic looking like he may have gone to the bot lane just to do that setup for the dragon, maybe kind of draw attention away from the Baron area, it wasn't clear, but now has returned to head up to the top side. We'll push out that massive wave building there, give over this bottom wave to Gap. Kalista now 210 to Sivir's 212. Relatively even. The mid lane, once even. Now a massive lead for Victor as he has finished the Business Scepter. Moving on to potentially a Deathcap or Zhonya.
Well, it's the difference about where the wave can be postured in the lane. If Victor is able to hold it near his tower, he's going to get a lot more free farm just because it's really unsafe for 19 to go that deep down the lane, especially with a character like Olaf in the game who doesn't really care about his Event Horizon safety.
A lot of the zoning tools used, all the zoning tools used by this team will be completely irrelevant in the face of Ragnarok. If at any point if it gets too far ahead, it just could spell the end for a Young Boss, despite the fact that they played much more cautiously, much more safely. Just not a forgiving champion
to allow getting ahead.
Much more patiently.
Although. Find the hook on Hidoko. Gonna get the cage down. He is gonna have to flash out of that one and will be safe. Hoka using the airbreak will to survive. Beggar in trouble as Gap will take out yet another one. Excellent zoning from the Alistar. Excellent aggressive play coming in from Mimic. And Pathos once again finding an advantage, picking up two in that fight, not even losing the Elise. The coordination from Young Boss just isn't there. The Flash Pulverize going in, they'll take another one. Hippo, two-man Gnar Ultimate, but it is not enough because Framer is getting soloed out on the back line. The Spell Shield used too early, doesn't even need the Rend as Gap closes that one out.
The calm before the storm. It just seemed like a very even, patient game, which was surprising to see out of a team like Pathos, who had snowballed so far ahead in the first game. I thought for sure they needed similar win conditions, but they show their patience, and then suddenly everything explodes. They get the Ace, the Dragon, and now the Baron.
Of course, the coordination for Young Boss just was not there. Ults used, not together. Separate little instances, once again, that Red Rover thing that we were talking about earlier today. But Pathos will secure that Baron, along with a 10k gold lead. The 4 second backs getting it out of there safely before Nonstop can even spot much of anything. This is now their opportunity to break inhibitor lines. And let's take a look at this fight again.
This is just so beautiful. So many cooldowns burned on Elise, but she's able to buy enough time for her team to teleport in with the repel. And then from here, it's gold lead speaking for themselves. But like you said, Mocha just doing such a great job on that ramp to make sure that Young Boss's team is split.
Young Boss just sticking around far too long. Why were they still there when the dragon was not going to get contested? It was not going to be theirs. Hoping for someone to make a mistake like Beggar. Pathos picks up yet another one. That pick should allow them to secure at least one tier 2 tower, if not more. They start to push in yet again, and once again looking like a highlight reel on the side of Pathos. 203, 215, 303, 305, and a 0094.
I think at this point they're really just solidifying the aspect that the first win in such a dominating fashion wasn't a one-off. It wasn't just a random snowball. They can be calculated.
Cage coming out trying to stop them from sieging. Normally a tool used to siege now, an anti-siege tool. Not wanting to push too far into that Veigar's effective wave clear, but Manji will be able to push into the mid lane, take out her tier 2 down, and just continue to extend this gold lead. 12k now. In the favor of Pathos.
Just systematically breaking Young Boss down. See how patient they're going to be with the siege, if we're going to possibly look for a dive with the Unbreakable Will up and live.
Find that base call is of course available as well. Lost all this Ragnarok. They can get aggressive if they want to. Intel going to be used to just ensure Joko's safety. It doesn't look like Mimic wants to get too aggressive. Excellent cage coming in there, but Moko will flash over the wall, get pulled back by the face call, and so many ultimates burn. Throwing the Alistar forward, they'll now shift their attention into the mid lane. Meganar, of course, already been triggered. Hippo has to find an engage shortly if he wants to find one at all, but it looks like they are just going to back off. Mocha very aggressive on that play, but not going to find much of anything for it.
Being so respectful of Young Boss's anti-siege, like you said, having that event horizon there, so it is dangerous to dive in Hib Towers. Instead, they're going to take the safe route. They're going to go ahead, spend all of the global gold that they've just accumulated over those free towers, reset the map, and look at that top tier last standing second.
Slow but steady, they are finding these advantages time and time again. 12k, just an absolutely oppressive gold lead at this stage of the game. It doesn't seem like there is much hope for Young Boss, but we've seen top teams like Najin, former top teams.
The Ferrari.
We've seen them make mistakes. It's not unreasonable to think that a less experienced team like Pathos could make a massive mistake, and a Young Boss, despite being inexperienced themselves, could punish it.
If Najin are a Ferrari, what are Anarchy? I feel they're like an off-road type of vehicle, like a utility vehicle.
Yeah.
But like a fancy one because they got Mickey. Like a Hummer. And they just bash you.
I feel like it's like a cheap functional, like it's like a Honda Civic with like a really big spoiler. Like the guy who just bought that really big spoiler and the really nice rims, and the cage is coming out, Mimic taking a little bit of damage. Nothing too exciting gonna happen there.
No, I like yours. I like the spoiler. Does Mickey get to be the spoiler?
Yeah, Mickey is the spoiler on this Honda Civic.
Everybody looks at it and goes, I don't really understand that. But the guy that owns the car is like, this is one sweet car.
It's got an awesome sound system now. They just installed it. It's starting to jungle.
What's more pressure? As we focus back in on this set, Pathos dominating. Continuing to extend that gold lead as no one is really going to be able to contest Mimic. It's very risky to approach this tower against an Olaf with Ragnarok and Ghost up. He may just go in.
He's got zero fear. The only reason he left is because the creeps weren't there. It didn't matter about the three champions. He didn't care.
The tower is the bigger threat at this stage of the game, and that's not where you want to be, a young boss. Especially almost 30 minutes in.
It's not where a young boss wants to be.
Young subordinate at this stage of the game, I would say.
I'm laying down so many sick intros for you, and you're just ignoring me.
It's not happening. I'm not putting a spoiler on the Honda Civic. I feel like you gave up on Nut after I shut you down, and now you're on to cars.
Monster Dragon in 20 seconds here. Beggar face checking into this. It's okay though. Doko wasn't in human form. Now he is.
Fire form. We'll still have the repel to get in there. As you're coming out, they're playing so aggressive. Teleport on the backside. That means Hippo and Mimic going in. Nonstop report's going to go down here. Beggar could be in trouble next. Not really a whole lot of hope here. Beggar after the flash,
but Sigmar's
Banshee goes in. Will pick that one up. Hippo will have Meganar shortly. Maybe able to turn this one around, but he will get burned down so quickly. Grabbing two with the ultimate as Mocha pushes in. Going in for Kramer. Kramer not going to spell shield anything in that exchange. Doko, ooh, the flash coming out for Hippo. A little bit late on that one. And Pathos just pushing into the base. They are so confident this stage of the game. Gap, seemingly non-existent in that team fight, will manage to pick up the kill over onto Hippo. Now it's just a matter of time before Pathos push in and break an inhibitor.
Again, they just got such an early lead that it's fairly difficult to ramp the game as quickly as they have and to really open up these inhibitors and seal the deal. They've done a good job being patient, trying to engineer these team fights around their controlled vision and find picks.
Of course, TP now coming in as well from the Veigar, as well as using the Elixir. Could find a pick here. He's having to pull up. They will try to find the stun. They're going to go down. So a small trade back, giving a little bit of gold over to Kramer.
We'll now turning their attention on the mid lane. See if the numbers advantage will give them the free tower. But the win condition has been opened up for Pathos. Not only do they have an oppressive gold lead, but they also have the fifth dragon looming on the future.
And it just feels like young boss are taking whatever they can, but at this point it is just scraps being presented to them from the small mistakes that Pathos are making.
There we go.
Being used, we could see the fight gap, not taking any damage in that exchange. Veigar not dishing out what is necessary as Beggar drops, nonstop trying to find something. Meganar will be on the way as two are trapped in the cage, knocking them both into the wall. A beautiful play from Hippo. But Mimic is just too strong. 19 is just too weak and is trying desperately to survive here as the laser nearly takes him out. One more axe, one more shot. Is it gonna be this one? It will be. Cleaning up there, five down, and now the Baron for Pathos.
While we're here, 5-0-6. Mimic again going massive on this Olaf. We'll see if this pick is respected for the rest of the tournament as Pathos are surely going to run away with this one, as Mimic's been doing all over them.
Just absolutely unstoppable. I cannot imagine this guy ever getting Olaf again, and I'm just wondering how deep the champion pool runs for him. What else can he play? Olaf not even considered a in-meta pick, but doing so well in the hands of Mimic.
I like Olaf.
I like Olaf too.
Oh, surrender!
Young boss. They've had enough. They do not want to be a part of Pathos' highlight reel, and Pathos doing absolutely dominating that set. A quick 2-0, showing confidence. They will advance to the round of 8. Kramer, smile on his face, but doesn't look too satisfied with the result. The rest of the members of the team realizing they were outclassed in that exchange. And that's just the nature of this tournament as a whole, is you have teams at the very top, and you have teams that are trying to rise. And right now, Pathos looking like they are at the top of the challenger scene.
I mean, effectively, you're sitting in a bracket that has a two-time world championship team. The competition is steep. It doesn't just start here with Pathos versus Young Boss. They should give themselves a pat on the back. They've got a sick name. But Pathos, they actually look surprisingly good. Not only being able to snowball and just having mechanical proficiency across the board, but in game two, showing a different element of their win condition, showing their patience, showing their ability to engineer picks around vision.
Definitely a team that we're going to have to watch as this tournament progresses, as well as into the challenger scene in the coming years. A team that I'm really excited about, the top laner, Mimic, of course, you know, that famous streamer. You can see why he's famous. That guy was pretty exciting to watch. Some pretty excellent Olaf plays overall. And I'm really curious to see how they're going to stack up in the round.
I mean, time will only tell. Again, it's kind of a different level of competition between the Korean Challenger Circuit as well as the LCK teams remaining in the tournament. Of course, Najin already kicked out, Anarchy moving forward, and joining them will be Pathos. But we're not done yet. We got one more game.
Yeah, one more team will join them in the round of the eight. Will it be Jin Air or will it be Longzhu Incredible Miracle? You guys are going to have to wait to find out. We have a 15-minute break. We'll be back with our third and final set of the night after that.